Well, good morning. Welcome to church. We're so glad that you are joining us online. And for those brave souls joining us live at 6 a.m., I want to welcome you and a bright and early morning. Colin, I'm thinking of you. And anybody else that may be joining us later on, good afternoon or good evening or maybe happy Monday. I don't know when you might be watching this, but I want to welcome you to our worship service online. We've been doing this for quite some time now, but we are looking forward to when we can come back together in person and fellowship together. But I want to encourage you to worship with us this morning as we join together from all over the state of Florida and from wherever you are joining us from. As we begin worship, I'm going to read the call to worship, which comes from Psalm 104. And we are going to start in verse 24. So if you want to grab your Bibles and turn to Psalm 104, starting in verse 24, says this: O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Here is a sea, great and wide, which teems with creatures innumerable, living things both small and great. There go the ships, the Leviathan, which you formed to play in it. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let sinners be consumed from the earth, and let the wicked be no more. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. church family. My name is Jim Lobb, and as chair of your pastor nominating committee, I'm excited to announce that the PNC has completed our 14-month search and has selected our nominee to become the next senior pastor of First Pres North Palm Beach. We have presented the nominee to the full session, and in response, they have called a congregational meeting for Sunday, June 14th, to hold the vote of the congregation on our nominee. Here's how this will unfold. Next Sunday, June 7, the PNC will present our nominee to the congregation through both a video and written presentation. At that time, you'll learn the nominee's name and key information. And then you'll see why we're excited to present our nominee to you. Then during the week following, PNC will take questions that you're free to pose through our PNC email contact on the First Pres webpage. Then on June 14, congregational meeting, the new pastor and spouse will be present in our sanctuary to preach prior to the congregational meeting vote. I know there are multiple questions as to how we're going to pull this off during these times of distancing and pre-recorded worship. But please pay close attention to upcoming announcements as to how this special service in the congregational meeting and vote will take place. The goal is that all members of First Pres have the opportunity to hear and view the new pastor and to attend the congregational meeting in order to cast your vote. This has been a long but fruitful process, and we as PNC want to thank you, the congregation, for your trust, your prayers, and your support throughout all these past months. Yes, we're excited to come to the end of this search, but we're much more excited to give the particular pastor nominee to you so that you can consider that pastor. As you'll learn next week, this nominee received the unanimous and enthusiastic support of the entire PNC team. We bring this nominee to you with confidence that God has directed our efforts and honored your faithful prayers. So, hold the date, June 14, continue to pray, and be watching for upcoming announcements on the details of this special meeting of our church body. Thank you.
As we continue our worship, we now turn our attention to God in prayer. And as we come together as a family, a couple things for us to remember as we pray. First of all, this is the end of the week where we have celebrated Memorial Day. And so it's a great reminder for us to continue to express our gratitude to God for those men and women who have sacrificed their lives for the sake of our country. Also, we have had another incident now involving the death of a young black man. And this is a concern for us as God's people as we consider how do we respond yet again to this ongoing kinds of injustice that are taking place. It's our hope that as God's people that we will respond, that we will not only pray to God for the injustice to end, but that we also might consider how we as God's people could impact our nation in bringing about unity, in bringing about reconciliation, and in truly expressing how we might live together in the way that God desires. So we want to pray for the situation this week in Minneapolis. We want to pray for George Floyd and his family. We want to pray for all of those that are affected by this, and also as we consider how we might respond to this injustice. So I invite you now to bow your heads and let us lift our prayers together. Almighty God, we come before you, enthroned in the heavens, sovereign over all creation. And we come to lift our voices in praise, and also to pause to express our gratitude to you. First of all, for sending your Son, who died on the cross that we might be reconciled to you. And we come to express our gratitude for the sending of your Spirit, that which we celebrate on this Pentecost Sunday. We're grateful, God, for how your Spirit fills our hearts, for how it is your Spirit that draws us together in unity, and for how your Spirit empowers us that we might serve you and be a witness for you. God, your Spirit also convicts of sin. And so we come to you to raise our prayers of confession for those times that we disobey, for the ways that we live apart from you. And God, we come to confess as a people how sin can infiltrate our society and infiltrate our hearts and in ways that we don't always understand or recognize. And so may your Spirit be at work in our hearts, showing us those places and those ways that we live separately from you. And may your Spirit also show us as a nation for how sin has become a part of our existence and has been woven into the fabric of our everyday lives. And God, we don't know how to move forward, but we come to you to say that through your Spirit we desire to move forward, to be reconciled with all peoples, and to live in unity as your people. We pray for those who are on the front lines of the coronavirus. May you continue to watch over them and work in them and through them. We pray for our teachers as the school year ends. We thank you, God, for their willingness to learn new ways to teach and for their sacrifice and servanthood in educating our students so that they might grow. And we pray for your church, God, for your people throughout the world. May your kingdom continue to advance. May you continue to watch over those who suffer oppression and who are persecuted for their faith. And we ask that your Spirit, God, might continue to draw us closer to you and might empower us so that we could use the gifts you have given to represent you out in the world and to continue, God, to serve you in a way that brings you glory and honor. And now we ask that you would hear us as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. As part of worship, we pause to give back to God in a very tangible way. We recognize that everything we have, that everything that we are, that it comes from God's hand, who invites us then to take what he has given and to give back so that the kingdom might be advanced in this world. For most of us who are hearing this worship service, we have been blessed in amazing ways. And it is such a privilege that we can use what God has given to bless other people, to express the love of God to other people, and to serve through the resources that God has given us. So let us pray. God, we thank you for your blessings, for all blessings flow from you. And we ask, God, that you would fill our hearts, that we would be grateful. And as an expression of our gratitude to you, that we would be willing to be a blessing to other people. So take now these offerings. May they be used to advance your kingdom in this world. Amen.
Well, today we have some exciting announcements. Exciting because we have missed gathering for worship, and as we contemplate, we will gather for the first time on June the 14th. There will be a series of services, and we will communicate that to you through all of the church media, but we have missed seeing you, and it will be a great joy to be together. We will also have a historic moment together on the 14th. As you have heard from our pastor nominating committee, we have a candidate, and that candidate will be in worship on that day and preach. You will have the opportunity to hear him, and then as we conduct the congregational meeting, both by Zoom for those who are not present and those who are present, we will hear the report of the pastor nominating committee and then have the opportunity to elect our next pastor. This is something for which we have prayed for the last 14 months. And I have to say that this is something that I have anticipated since my sabbatical in 2015. It feels like we are on the threshold of a historic moment for First Pres, for our new pastor, and for me. It's a moment. Also, want to say that one of the elements of doing our worship online is that our response is delayed. And this past week, I heard from one of our elders who said that he missed the humor from Ron and from me in worship. And both Ron and I felt like our humor tends to be so reactive and based on immediate observation and spontaneous that being funny on our own alone is not something that we do particularly well or even think about. My wife is here, and my wife thinks that I should have a t-shirt that says, "I crack me up." And while that is true, I seem to need an audience. And right now, my audience is Penny and Eddie. But I did see some things that I thought were a little bit funny and have included one other thing in the sermon that I think that you might think is a bit amusing too. But if you are watching this online, you may have noticed that we began with the candles not lit. On the day that we saw tongues of fire over the apostles' head as this great symbol of the Holy Spirit appeared and hovered over them. And yet somehow or another, we started this service without the candles lit. And you may have noticed that the bookmark that began white for the season of Easter has magically become red in the middle of the service. We have one Sunday a year that it is red, and that is Pentecost Sunday. And so, poof, there it is. So I want you to know that Josh Bartz, who began the service, prayed and fire and the red color for Pentecost has appeared in answer to his prayers. Also, I would point out to you that both Ron and I, remembering that it was Pentecost, wore red ties to be liturgically correct, since we were not wearing robes and stoles. As we look at our four texts for this Sunday, our call to worship was a part of Psalm 104. And Psalm 104 has parallels with an ancient song of Egypt. It's not certain that the psalmist knew that song, but Yahweh is depicted in a similar way to the god Aten in Egypt that was an attempt to refine the Egyptian pantheon down to a single god to worship. But in this psalm, God is praised as the psalmist stands back and looks at the intricacy of nature and its interdependence and connectedness. And he praises Yahweh, the God of Israel, as the creator and the upholder or sustainer of all creation. And then, in the text that we have, calls upon Yahweh to send forth his spirit and renew the face of the ground. Recalling the picture of Genesis 1:2 of the Spirit of God hovering over the face of the deep and bringing order out of the chaos, life out of lifelessness, and light out of darkness. Psalm 104 anticipates a second creation, a second recreation by means of the Holy Spirit. And this new creation or rescue or redemption of the earth would manifest the glory and the presence of Almighty God, which will issue forth in the purification of the earth and the removal of all wickedness. That history has a trajectory, and that trajectory is ultimately in a realm in which God's will is done on the earth as it is in heaven. In John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23, included for your meditation this week, Jesus' goal is to establish a realm or a sphere of shalom, of peace, of right order. And that must be done after he departs and gives authority to his apostles to govern that ever-widening circle of faith and faithfulness according to his application and interpretation of God's Torah, of God's commands. In our other scripture for your meditation, a famous passage from Paul's 12th chapter in his first letter to the Corinthians that says that each believer is given a manifestation of the Spirit within the body of Christ, and that there is in the body of Christ diversity in unity by the work of one Holy Spirit. Each member of the body has value and each member of the body adds value. And every other member is related to and dependent upon every other member. Each believer has a role to play within the unfolding of God's rescue of this planet. That we are not to be spectators watching professional believers, but that we are all representatives, as we were created to be, of God Himself. So we must look beyond our family and our tribe and our nation and our neighborhood. Like Abraham, we have been blessed by God to be a blessing to others, so that the gospel of Jesus Christ is incompatible with racism and sexism and ageism and exploitation and manipulation and deception. None of these things can be permitted within the realm of Christ's authority. And this brings us to the famous passage in Acts chapter 2 of the events of that Pentecost, that great feast of weeks that took place just 7 weeks after the crucifixion of Jesus. So hear the word of the Lord as we find it in Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others, mocking, said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, 9 a.m. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel." And he quotes, "And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And may the Lord our God add his richest blessing to the reading and our hearing of his holy word. And would you bow your heads and hearts with me for a word of prayer? O Lord, our God, on this Pentecost Sunday, as we remember the outpouring of your Holy Spirit and its transforming power on the lives of the apostles and all who heard the gospel, your mighty acts for our deliverance. Lord, how we give you thanks for your word alone is truth. And we would pray for the one who speaks this day that you might forgive him his sins, which are many. And that by the grace and power of your Holy Spirit, that you might not allow those sins to pollute or distort your message. And we pray for ourselves as we listen, that by the grace and power of that same Holy Spirit, that you might write the truth of your word on the tablets of each of our hearts, that we might not sin against you, but at the day of Jesus Christ, on the day of his appearing, be found like him, holy and blameless, without spot or blemish, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, I was in the back of my mind thinking about humorous things, and one of the things that was brought to my attention was that First Presbyterian Church itself has had an experience not unlike this. That in fact, tongues of fire have appeared on Reverend Hilliard. That while he was in Cuba on a mission trip, fire, which has been a sign and a symbol of the presence and power of God, both to save and to judge, it has been an emblem of God's Spirit, showed up on Ron. And so I have asked that this picture that was taken in Cuba might be seen by all of you as a tongue of fire was seen coming out of Reverend Hilliard. I do hope that brings a bit of a smile to you. But I have to tell you again, it feels a little flat in here. Pentecost was a great feast of Israel. It was one of the three great pilgrim feasts when Jews were expected to come to the temple. It was a great harvest feast, and it was also celebrated as the anniversary of Moses receiving the Torah on Mount Sinai. But it was also remembered as the great day of Israel's fall at the golden calf. Pentecost, in the year that Jesus died and was raised again from the dead, is the completion of the transformation from the old covenant to the new covenant administration of God's relationship with his people. And as Moses and Luke, as Moses tells the story, as Luke writes the story, they reflect upon God making and keeping extraordinary promises over millennia of time. Luke writes and Peter preaches, trying to tie the events of this day to stories that people already knew. Stories of creation, of Noah and his sons, of the Tower of Babel and the confusion of languages, of the giving of the Torah to Moses on Mount Sinai and his descent to find that Aaron, his brother, had fashioned an idol and that Israel was worshiping it as its rescuer and deliverer and God. And similarly, in Acts chapter 2, we are told that as the Spirit of God is poured out, and as it inspires speech about God's mighty acts of deliverance in the past and in the present, that it creates such an impact on its hearers that they respond with extravagant and gracious generosity, so that they took care of one another. Also, we hear about the rush of the mighty wind and the liturgical passages read in the temple that day included Ruth, but they also included Ezekiel chapter 1, where God shows up in the appearance and the sound of this rush of a mighty wind. So as they are hearing the scripture read, they actually then see it being fulfilled before their very eyes. As Moses writes and tells the story of Genesis, he writes it after he has already experienced God's great Exodus deliverance from bondage in Egypt to deliver them to the foot of Mount Sinai. And he writes Genesis in light of that experience in the Exodus. He writes about the 10 times God speaks in light of the 10 words of Torah that he received on Mount Sinai. But the Torah, the instruction, the words and commands of God establish a realm or a kingdom where Yahweh's will is done on earth as it is to be done in heaven. This was true at Mount Sinai, but it is also true of the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden is told in the way that it is told because of the experience of Moses and Israel at Mount Sinai. Last week, we focused primarily on Jesus' ascension into heaven, to be seated on the right hand of God, enthroned with authority as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But he told his disciples that it was necessary for him to go so that the Spirit could be poured out. And now he tells them to wait in the city until they are clothed with power from on high. The outpouring of the Spirit, followed by the proclamation of the establishment of the kingdom of Christ, or the Lord's anointed one, is a declaration of the transfer of authority from Herod's temple to Christ's temple. From Caesar's authority, his worldly governmental authority, to Christ's heavenly and kingdom-oriented authority. From earthly kings to the kingdoms of God. And the establishment of the true Israel, who would rule with Christ over the nations, beginning in Jerusalem and radiating out to Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. And as the prophecy of Joel is read, the implications of that amazing prophecy is that ethnicity and nationality and language group and gender and socioeconomic status were all to be transcended in this new kingdom as the reign of Israel's king is expanded and his realm becomes universal. In Pentecost, we see God fulfilling his promise, and we see God equips a remnant for a task that is way too big for them. We see God empower the unqualified for a mission that is way too vast for them. And we see God sending the unprepared to cultures and countries too far and too diverse to even imagine. Peter calls upon his hearers to call upon the name of the Lord and be saved, rescued from this present evil age, delivered from the dominion of darkness in order to dwell in the presence of God in his glory, to fulfill the mission of humanity at creation, to be the image and representatives of God, and to create on earth a place where God's will is done joyfully. God's shalom is experienced everywhere, among everyone, forever and ever and ever. And to prepare a people to face the final judgment of God, and to hear ultimately from his lips, "Well done, thou good and faithful servants. Enter into the kingdom prepared for you from before the foundations of the earth. What does it mean to call on the name of the Lord? It means to acknowledge that in the past, like Israel, we have not trusted or relied on the Lord to care for us. We have each gone our own way. We have each turned in on ourselves and sought to meet our own needs, and we have failed as a result to love our neighbors as ourselves, which invariably leads to a world and relationships of darkness, not light, of chaos, not shalom, and of lifelessness, not life. The prophet Joel declared, and Peter preached, that Yahweh, our Creator, has sent His Son as our Redeemer. And if we will confess our sins and our need for a Savior, He will receive us, He will forgive us, He will restore us and cleanse us, empower and employ each one of us in His relentless, loving quest to bring His shalom and His wholeness to this world, starting with us and starting now. What Peter offered on that day is still available today, but there will be a day when it will be too late. Paul advises those in the church, saying, while today is still today, call upon the name of the Lord. I'd like to offer you the opportunity to pray and to receive Christ as your Savior. And let's pray. Well, blessed are you, Lord God. You are the Creator, and you are the rescuer of this earth and the rescuer of human beings, heart by heart, life by life. Lord, you know each of our stories. You know how we have gone our own way. We have trusted and tried to meet our own needs with our own resources. And Lord, we have not trusted you. We ask that you might forgive us of our sins, that you might transform our hearts and our affections to be more and more like your heart and your affections, that we might love those that you love, and that you might use our lives and our manifestations of your Holy Spirit to light this dark world and to transform and transcend the divisions and the disharmony that is so evident all the time in the world that we live in. Lord, how we pray that you would restore our hearts, and from our hearts make us a blessing to others. As you have been generous and kind to us, we pray that you would teach us by your Holy Spirit to be a generous and kind people who represent you faithfully, who make your light to shine in this world that others may see and give glory to God our Father. For this, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, if you have prayed that prayer, my further prayer for you is that God might show up in your life in such a way that you cannot miss His calling, that you cannot miss His presence, and that you will experience His power to change you day by day into Christ's likeness and fill your hearts with Christ's joy. Pentecost is a day to celebrate, a day to celebrate the goodness of our God in creation and in new creation. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, and he said, if anyone is in Christ, the old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. He is a new creature. If you prayed that prayer, God will make you a new creation. May the joy of the Lord fill you now and forevermore. Amen.
Sound that saved a wretch like me. A was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear!
Before we pronounce the benediction, I hope you will circle on your calendars June the 14th, a day of great importance in the life of our congregation and its future. If you are able to come, I hope you will. I think you will be blessed to hear the man that God is calling to be our next pastor. I think your hearts will be encouraged as you meet he and his family. And I pray that you will come and hear the report of the pastor nominating committee and be encouraged that First Presbyterian Church's best days are before it and not behind it. And now, would you bow your heads to receive God's blessing? Beloved of the Lord Jesus, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and fill your hearts with his shalom now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.